So last session, we started working with data in the form of a video. And a video, you can treat it as several contiguous frames in time. So it's going to be several contiguous images in time. It is still structured data. It has a structure. It's going to be on a two-dimensional grid. And you're going to have that two-dimensional grid evolving over time. So now you have three dimensions rather than two to worry about. And there are two important data sets. These are two benchmarks that I highly encourage you to do exploratory data analysis on them. They are not big data sets. They are of moderate size to small size. It's UCF 101 from YouTube videos, and it has 101 categories, and the other one has 51 categories. It's for action recognition. So one observation that you can make about videos is that you can naturally decompose them into spatial and temporal components. So that's going to be the main observation here. It means that you can have two streams. One is going to look at the spatial structure of your video, and that's going to be the spatial stream of your convolutional neural network. And that's just the CNN. That's what we covered so far in the course. There is also another component for the temporal stream. And rather than taking inputs as images, the temporal stream is going to take inputs in the form of optical flow. But what is an optical flow? But the rest of it is very similar. You just have more channels. Rather than only red, green, blue, you're going to have more channels in the temporal stream. But then the rest of it is just the same convolutional network. And in the end, you just either vote, which could be as simple as averaging out the outputs of the softmax to give you the final class score, or you can have a classifier at the end, like support vector machine, that takes as input these probabilities, and then it's going to output the corresponding class. So the main contribution is this. What is an optical flow? This has nothing to do with deep learning. There are actually deep learning algorithms that are going to give you optical flows. But what is it? Let's focus on this part of the image. This is just your zooming in. There is optical flow everywhere, from this frame of your video to the next frame of the video. But let's just zoom in there. And your optical flow is going to be a set of displacement vectors. So at each pixel, you're going to have a displacement vector that's taking you, for instance, from this point in this frame to this point in the next frame. So it takes you from one point in frame T to another point, to the same point in frame T plus one, because the arm of this person is moving from one frame to the next one. And that's going to give you a bunch of vectors. And you're going to have that vector for each pixel. So you're going to have dt of u and v. U and v is going to be your pixel. And for each pixel, you're going to have a vector. And each vector is going to have an x component and a y component, because it's a 2D vector. This is the x component. You can actually visualize it now. And that's the y component. Now you begin to see what's happening here. It's the x component, that's the y component, that's the x component of the next frame, the y component of the next frame, etc. And this is supposed to model the temporal evolution in your video. And the idea is that your displacement vector is moving a point to the corresponding point in the next frame. And as I said, it's going to have an x component and a y component. Now the idea is you're going to stack your optical flow vectors, the x component and the y component, and that's going to be an input to your neural network. Now you have two options for stacking these optical flows. Let's say you have L consecutive frames. For each frame, you're going to have an optical flow, and each flow is going to have x component and y component. And let's say you're currently at frame tau. That's the index of the frame that you're currently sitting at, and you want to create this input. It's going to have the same size, the same resolution in the space for your width and height. And then you're going to have two L of them. And you have two options for stacking them. This is the first option. For the odd ones, you use the X component. For the even ones, you're going to use the Y component. And that's the way you're going to stack them on top of each other for L consecutive frames. And that's exactly what you're seeing here. And visually speaking, you're at frame tau, at frame tau, you have a displacement vector for this pixel, and your pixel is always u and v, and that's going to be your first vector. It's going to have x component, y component. Then you go to the next frame, you're still at the same point, u and v. You take the x component, y component, stack them, and you go to the next frame and you do the same thing. And here your L is, for instance, 2. Therefore, you're going to have your L is 3. This is 1, 2, and 3. And therefore, you're going to have a 6-dimensional or 6 channels of optical flows. Another option is to follow the trajectory of a point that is evolving from one frame to the next one. Still, the odd ones are going to be the x component, the even ones are going to be the y component. But now your point is changing by your flow. Rather than it being fixed, it's now changing. And the way that it's changing is using the displacement vectors. And visually speaking, it's going to become more clear. This is exactly the same point u and v that you started with in frame tau. Previously, you were using the same p1 for your next frame. Now in your p2 is going to come from p1 plus the displacement. And at this point in frame tau plus 1, you're going to have a displacement vector, which is going to take you to p3, etc. And these are going to be your vectors now. So you have two options to model time. And because your task is a classification task, you're doing action recognition, you take the entire frame or your entire video. You have that information and then you want to classify it. It's not a sequential task. It means that not only you can go forward in time, you can go backward in time as well. And that's going to give you a bidirectional flow. You go forward and backward. For instance, you're sitting at this point. What was the previous optical or displacement at frame tau minus one? So you're going to include those ones as well. Any questions so far? Is everything clear?
Yeah, I had a question. I'm more familiar, I've done stuff with like sparse optical flow, and I know in that case it's sort of noisy, like it can make mistakes, that whatever algorithm you use. Is that the same case in dense optical flow? Like, can you get, I guess, mistakes in your data itself?
Yes, definitely. It's not an easy problem solving this on its own.
Yeah, and so I guess is that just sort of a part of the net? There's no extra work to sort of try to account for that?
Not really. So you take that as an input to your network. And this data could be noisy, and you're correct.
Right.
Depending
as long.
Yes, go ahead.
I was going to say, as long as you use the same algorithm, you'd hope it fails in the same sort of way at evaluation time.
Yes, exactly. So
that could be one way.
Yeah. So these optical flows, it's a hard problem, actually. And for this paper, we are assuming that we know that. But it's a classical problem.
So I have a question about how the optical flow is created. Is it generated from the color images, or is it something that we would need like a LiDAR or a Microsoft Kinect to generate?
No. So as long as you have two images, there are algorithms that are going to give you your optical flows, your displacement vectors. So you know, you need to know how far apart these two images are in your video. And then there are multiple ways to do it. One way is that there is a partial differential equation that you can solve. That's going to give you your vector. But there are multiple ways to solve this problem. You can actually have a neural network and train that.
Okay.
But the information that the algorithm needs to give you these optical flows are only two consecutive images, two consecutive frames.
I see.
This and that is going to give you this. So this frame, the next frame, is going to give you your displacement vectors. And the way that it's going to do it is by looking at the red, green, blue components.
I see.
Any other questions?
I had one other sort of higher level question, but it seems weird to me that the temporal and the spatial stream don't really communicate till the very end. Like, it seems like there'd be useful information at intermediate feature maps. I wonder if, do we get to a net that does some of that, crosses the streams?
So we're going to see at least one more paper, and they're gonna communicate at some point before you're fully connected layer. So it doesn't have to communicate after the softmax. It could communicate here, for instance. That's a great question, actually. And that's a great observation. We're gonna see a paper that does that.
Cool. Okay.
But let's see some results. If you only look at the spatial component, just the spatial stream, and if you train from scratch, that's going to be your accuracy, 42 and 52. But if you pre-train your network, for instance, on ImageNet, and then fine-tune it, you manage to boost the performance. And if you pre-train, fix the layers, and then only fine-tune the last layer, that depends, your result is going to depend on your dropout. And if your dropout is moderate, it's 0.5, that's going to give you 72%. So that's just the spatial component. If you only look at the temporal component, the best one seems to be your optical flow stacking, where your L is 10 and you have a bidirectional optical flow going backward and forward in time. And mean subtraction being on is just normalizing your data. You are normalizing your optical flow, because we know that neural networks like normalized data. They're going to converge better. Okay. So even the temporal component alone is giving you pretty good results. And the next one is combining these two and then having a mechanism to at the end give you your class score. And you're going to do it on two of your data, both of your data sets. This paper we saw, Slow Fusion is the previous paper that we saw, and that was 65.4% accurate. If you use two-stream model, you can actually either use averaging or you can use a support vector machine. And it turns out the support vector machine, because it has its own training step, is doing better compared to simple averaging of the results of these two softmax. And these numbers are just coming from these numbers here. It's around the same number, and this is the temporal component, and this is when you fuse the two. Okay, any questions?
I had another like higher level question, but I'm guessing like a baseline in using videos would be to combine like an object detector with a more classical model, like a decision tree or something. I was wondering if there's any, like off the top of your head, work, you know, that tries that out. Like instead of using the temporal information, just simply use like what's in each frame and then combine that intelligently.
So that's the question of intelligently. And these guys are trying to be intelligent, actually.
That's true.
So yeah. That's the question of how do you incorporate time? Because we know how to handle space. We learned a lot about it, but it's now about time.
Right. Okay. But I guess I'm thinking of more of like a, like you encode some information about the task, like, and then have some sort of like object detection where you're saying like, you know, this is a bow. And if there's a bow in the task, it's likely shooting arrows or whatever the task is called. So more semantic information, I guess.
Yes, but the whole purpose of deep learning is to work with raw data. So you don't want to incorporate prior knowledge in them. So you don't want to say, if there is a bow in your image, then do that. You want the network to be able to understand that there is a bow and there is a movement, and therefore it's somebody shooting the bow. Okay.
Right. Yeah.